Welcome, everyone, to this evening's program. My name is Awadhendra Sharan, and I'm the director of the Center for the Study of Developing Societies, Delhi. Our speaker this evening is Dr. Murad Banaji. Dr. Banaji is a mathematician at Middlesex University, UK. His main academic interests are in the theory of dynamic systems with applications in biology, chemistry, and medicine. Dr. Banaji has tracked India's COVID-19 epidemic closely and written about it in various newspapers, drawing our attention to the strengths and weaknesses of different data sources through which we may track the epidemic, regarding estimates, especially undercounting of the extent of infection and mortality, and most importantly, why does accurate data matter in dealing with the epidemic? Equally interesting, at least for me, is that in several of his writings, he presents a more easily graphical set of arguments for the lay reader, with a link provided for a more technical version, should one be interested. And I found that writing style very interesting, the two papers in one. This evening, Dr. Banaji talks to us on lessons from India's pandemic data. Dr. Murad Banaji.
Well, first of all, thank you so much for inviting me to speak at CSDS. And I'm very happy that I get an opportunity these days to speak to audiences who are not maybe my kind of traditional academic audience of mathematicians and scientists. And I often learn as much as I'm able to actually communicate myself from those interactions. And so let me kind of start by giving a brief background of how I came to looking at COVID. I'm not an epidemiologist. I feel it's important to say that. I'm not really a person who understands epidemics and pandemics pre the COVID pandemic, but I am a mathematician who's looked at disease modeling and looked at the progression of disease in a more kind of physiological sense over quite a period of time. And I've looked at kind of biological and medical models. And I've had an interest in epidemiology, but really my kind of current focus on COVID-19 comes more out of the immediacy of the pandemic, the importance of looking at what's going on and trying to understand it. And what I'm going to try to communicate today is largely about the data analysis side of this work. And there's another side of the work that I've done on COVID-19, which I would call more of kind of mathematical modeling, which I do much less of these days because in some ways the situation has got more complicated and to keep up with it requires a lot of effort and ideally a team of people rather than an individual. But the mathematical modeling was also how I started out, trying to actually write down some equations, which will tell you how the situation is going to evolve over time, write down some computer programs, which tell you what's going to happen with the epidemic or try to explain what might be happening already. And that work really sometimes threw up some discrepancies, which led to some of the exploration that I'll be telling you about shortly. I'll be talking to you for a bit, and then I'll also share some slides during this because I want to give some examples of the kind of the kind of conceptual ideas that I'm talking about. I want to give some concrete examples of those as well. So let me try to keep myself on time by starting a stopwatch as I speak. Okay. The first observation really is that we've had a lot of data coming out of India's pandemic. Increasingly, as time went on, we saw more and more and more data. And yet at the same time, we've also had a lot of dodgy stories, a lot of what you could call misinformation or disinformation, which somehow sits alongside this data. And just to kind of clarify, I use both of those words, misinformation and disinformation, because I feel, I mean, there's a difference between the two. Misinformation is where you perhaps incorrectly interpret some data or spread a story, but without really any intention to mislead people. And disinformation is where there's actually some intention to mislead. And it's not always obvious when you have pandemic commentary which is going clearly wrong in some cases, whether we're looking at misinformation or whether there's an actual intention to mislead. But anyway, we've had a lot of stories which have been apparently constructed from data and which have been widely circulating around the Indian pandemic, which have sometimes fallen apart as more knowledge and data comes through. Sometimes they've been clearly wrong from the beginning, and you could say that they were just kind of constructed based on incorrect assumptions right from the start. And the thing about these stories is that they appear to draw heavily on data. I mean, just in a kind of simple-minded sense, they're often accompanied by charts and graphs and streams of numbers. And this appears to give them some kind of legitimacy that they wouldn't otherwise have. If people, otherwise they would just appear like speculation, but somehow accompanying them with charts and graphs makes them appear like legitimate claims about the pandemic, even when sometimes they are not necessarily so. And what's the kind of source of these kind of sometimes quite bizarre or absurd claims, in fact, which have come out? Is it about different data cultures? Is it about different communities of people, the epidemiologists and the economists and the medical doctors studying things in their different ways and not being able to communicate properly about it? Is it just propaganda, a desire to construct a narrative which is kind of suits people in political power? Is it something more complicated than that? And does it arise from shortcomings in the data itself, or does it arise from shortcomings in how the data is being looked at? So these are some of the questions that I'm interested in. I'm not going to answer a lot of those questions, but those are the things that came to my mind when I was asked to give this talk. And you know, to give some examples, just some kind of crude examples, especially from the early days of the pandemic, you had things like the Tablighi Jamaat incident, where the claim was made, including by those in government, that this one event, the Tablighi Jamaat gathering in Delhi, had considerably accelerated the Indian pandemic. There was no evidence, and there was no evidence for that. And in fact, it was a very implausible claim at the time, but it was made apparently on the basis of data on cases. You've had claims about low mortality. That's one of my particular hobby horses. You've often had claims of low mortality, this time actually made on the basis of some data, but data whose inadequacies needed to be factored in, which needed to be considered in its broader context and understood a lot better before those claims were being made. We don't really know how such claims have impacted policy and impacted decisions about management of the pandemic. But sometimes we certainly have a strong feeling that some of these kind of claims, for example, about low mortality, how India has been relatively spared the worst during the first wave, might have impacted, might have caused a sense of complacency that preceded the second wave, both in government circles and then perhaps amongst the wider population as well. So we don't fully understand the impacts of those narratives, but they probably have had a major impact. There's also been misinformation of a kind which is not unique to India, which you'll see across the world, where you have theories which are sometimes not backed up by very much evidence, but are somebody's pet theory, and if, especially if that is somebody with some degree of influence, then it can become quite a kind of major theory. For example, one of these theories which has circulated from early on in the pandemic is that Indians are somehow naturally protected from severe COVID. So that's why we're seeing lower mortality. So it was a theory which was circulating in response to apparently low mortality in India. It was to attempt to give it some reason, some kind of basis. But it was held very strongly, certainly until the second wave, by a lot of people. So you certainly see it circulating quite a lot, and you would even see it in some academic papers as well. And then, of course, there were kind of broader themes around the effects of certain drugs, which